Hello, and welcome to the second tutorial in the series on getting started with Foxdot. This time we'll be looking at the pattern and time file classes, which can help make your life easier when live coding with Foxdot. In most programming languages, you have a data type called an array. Python calls them lists, which are used to store multiple pieces of data. And in a musical sense, we could store things like a series of pitches or rhythms. So in Python, to create a list, we use square brackets and put our data in separated by commas. So A here is a list, and if I print A, I can see it there in the console and its contents. Performing mathematical operations on lists in Python can be a little bit tricky. If, for example, I use the asterisk, which is usually multiplication in maths, it actually just repeats the list two times. So if I did that, see, it repeats it two times two, which is four times, which may not be what we want it to be. In Python, probably the easiest way to multiply each value in a list is to do list comprehension, which looks like this, which is A equals the value times 2. Yeah, I have to go through the list and multiply it. So if I print A now, we get the list that we were after in the first place, but that's a little bit of extra typing that we don't really want to undo. In Foxdot, we have a class called the pattern class, which does this for us basically, and that can be instantiated as you would do any other class by giving the name and round brackets, and the first argument is a list. So you can see the pattern is the P followed by a list of data. That's how you know something is a pattern. So if I do A multiply 2, we get 0, 2, 4, which is what we wanted to get in the first place. You can also use a shorthand, which is just to put the uppercase P followed by a list of data. And that also gives us a pattern with the data that we've put in there. The other good thing about using the shorthand is that we can incorporate series into our pattern by using a colon. So if I did 0, 1, 2, and then 3, colon, 9, the 3, colon, 9 adds 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So the 3 to 8, 3 to n minus 1, which is common in programming, to our list, and saves us quite a lot of typing, especially if we want to do something like if we want to do a large series like 3 to 20, so it saves us some typing there. So mathematical operations are handled quite easily with patterns, so multiplication and addition. Handles there. In Python, using the plus symbol with another list will put the list together, we'll append one onto the other. To do that with patterns, we use the bar symbol, which is usually shift plus backslash, and you can use a list or a pattern. Well, and you can see we get the two patterns merged together like so. As a class in Python, it has a bunch of useful methods for returning new versions of patterns. I'll get into more depth into these another time, but we'll look at just one for now. You can run help pattern, and we'll get a bunch of useful information here in the console. So here's all the methods. The documentation and the doc strings are pretty lacking at the moment. I'm going to improve. improve those soon, I hope. So we'll pick stretch for now. So here is our pattern. I can use dot stretch, and stretch takes one argument, which is an integer, and it stretches the pattern so it is that length. So stretch 8 gives us a pattern with 8 values in it, so we get the pattern repeated 0, 1, 2, 0, 1, 2, 0, 1. So we can listen to that as a melody. Most pattern methods can take a list of numbers and repeat the function number of times based on the arguments you give it. So if we give stretch a list 5, 3, we'll get the list stretched to length 5, followed by the list stretched to length 3. So this is what it looks like. You get 0, 1, 2, 0, 1, that's stretched to 5, and then 0, 1, 2, stretched to 3. So it sounds a bit different. Hopefully you can hear the difference there. There are also a few functions in Foxdot for creating patterns. I can see info on these by running help patterns with an S dot sequences, and that will scroll up and we'll see this is the list of functions in that module. So a couple of useful ones are ptry and pdir we'll look at as well. That's a useful one. But yeah, there's a couple in there for you to have a look at in your own time. So ptry gives or creates a pattern from 0 to n, n being the argument we give it, and then reverses that. So if I use ptry 10, it gives us values 0 to 10, then back. So this is what ptry 8, I mean, that makes sense, ptry 8 sounds like. So that just goes up and down a scale, which is quite useful. And like the methods, we can give it a list of arguments. So we'll get up to 4 and back, then up to 8 and back. The other function I method pdir, it's kind of complicated to explain. I'll post a link in the description about Euclidean rhythms, but the summary is this. If I want a note to occur, say, 3 times over 8 quarter steps, I type pdir 3 for the 3 events, 8 for the number of quarter steps, and it gives us durations of these events, which is a rhythm, essentially. So here's what it sounds like. We'll just get rid of the notes. And again, I can put a list in there, and that will give us 3 notes over 8 steps, followed by 5 notes over 8 steps. So that's the basics of patterns. sometimes we want to use a chord sequence or a value that we hear for a number of beats of bars rather than number of occurrences. So for example, we go back to our earlier pattern, and let's say we want to shift this melody up a fourth every 8 beats, let's say. So every 8 beats, I want to add 3 to it, basically. So I could type that out manually. So I'd have to work out three notes is 2 beats. So I'd have to do 12 times. And then a 3, 12 times. That's a lot of typing. We could use the stutter method of the pattern. So you create a pattern and stutter it 12 times. Print that so you see what that looks like. That dot 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 there to just take out the middle part of a pattern. So that gives us what we want. But if we change our duration, so it doesn't actually last 8 beats anymore, because our rhythm, the number of notes, is changing. So what we would use here is something called a time var, where we store a value that changes over time. So we create a var, a time var, or a var for short, and give it 2 lists. One is the values, and the other is the durations. So that can be a list, or it can be a single number, if they're all the same, for example. Okay, so so if we create a bass that plays the note 0 for 4 beats, 1 for 2 beats, 2 for 1 beat, and then 3 for 1 beat. This is how it sounds. So even though the durations change, the pitch is always relative to the number of beats. So in our original problem, we can just add a var where we have 0 and 3 lasting 8 beats. So I mentioned chord progressions earlier. What might be useful is to create a chord sequence that multiple players could use, and then change that chord sequence later on and update all the players. So the best way to do this is to create a var, but it's a named var. So it's var dot and the name of your variable equals var. And the reason for this is because it creates a name and dictionary that I can update by repeating, just rerunning the code, because it knows there's a var called chords and updates the values rather than creating a new var called chords. Yeah, you'll understand this shortly, hopefully. So we'll create the bass. Thank you. just rerun that code and change the values, and any player using that named var was updated. So that's a really easy way to create chord progressions if you're doing sort of song-based music. Just like with how pattern functions could use lists of data to create multiple lists squished on to the end of each other, you can use a var within those to create patterns that change over time. For example, Peter 3, 5 in brackets gave us Peter 3, that's those values there, and then a Peter 5 sort of amended on there. If I want it to be a Peter 3, 8 and then a 5, 8 for 4 beats. What this does, it creates a Peter 3, 8 for 4 beats, and that changes. So 4 beats later, we have a Peter 5, 8. So we can listen to how that sounds. That with almost any pattern type. So with our P try, we do that for a melody, for example. So for 8 beats, it'll go up to 4 and back, and then it'll go up to 8 and back for 4 beats. So that's it for the basics on patterns and time vars, but I'll dive into these in more detail in future, but they should hopefully give you a bit of a flavour for how you can use them in your own compositions. Thank you for watching, and see you next time.